have the pleasant opportunity of introducing the next opening batsman, Narayana Murthy. Yes, Narayana Murthy. Kadugu siruthalum kaaram koraiyadunu solvaanga. So Narayana Murthy is like that. Though he looks small in stature, he stands tall among all his colleagues and the next generation. And he finished his MBBS in JIPMER. Then he did his MS General Surgery in Stanley Medical College, and he went to Calcutta for his MCH. And after coming back, and he did a couple of fellowships, one in Tata Memorial. Then he spent some time with Fu Chanwei in Taiwan, and he also went to Korea to spend some time with JP Hong. And I've seen him very enthusiastic and lovely young personality, always smiling. In any conferences, we can't miss him. And he has joined a good team of plastic surgeons in Savita. Currently, he's an associate professor there. And they have formed a good team. Once again, all youngsters, what I would like to wish is you form a good team along with your like-minded people, and your work will definitely be better. So I take this opportunity to introduce Narayana Murthy, and he's going to talk on medial plantar artery flap and the heel pad avulsion, their experience. Over to you, Narayana Murthy.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your kind words. Good evening, one and all. Greetings from Savita Medical College, Chennai. First, I'd like to express my gratitude to Professor G.K. Sir, G.B. Sir, T.C.C. Sir, Purushottam Sir, and Sridhar Sir for giving us a platform to express our work in this forum. So, to start with, heel pad is a complex structure which consists of a glabrous skin, a subcutaneous fat, and dense septations which hold the pad into multiple compartments. With this complex structure, it helps the heel pad to bear the weight of the body, to restrict any shearing force, and to act as a shock absorber. Due to various reasons like infective, as it happens with diabetic foot, post-traumatic in case of avulsion of the heel, and tumor resections and unstable scars. When this is gone, it is important for us to reconstruct the heel pad with a good vascular, durable sensate tissue, whose anatomy matches as close to the heel pad as possible. So when you look around for tissue, the most common site that we find is the instep area, where the defect and the area which is the skin, the type of skin that is present in the heel and in the instep area are very similar. And also the presence of the local, and also when we take tissue from the local tissue, it helps in the post-operative wound healing, where the tissue interface between a glabrous skin along with the glabrous skin, with the glabrous skin, is going to have a smoother healing process when compared to any other kind of tissue replacing the heel pad. It also enables good functionality, and the patient is able to walk, stand, and run on the feet. So the choice of flap will be from the instep area will be medial plantar artery flap, and it is based on the medial plantar artery and nerve, so that it becomes a sensate flap. First, when we started doing this flap, it was a very difficult flap. Personally, for me, it was a very difficult flap when compared to any other flap that we have elevated. Simply because of the reason, once we apply the tourniquet after elevation, we make the incision over the flap. Once we get into the plantar aponeurosis, inside that, the first point is we are very unsure about whether it is a plantar aponeurosis or a tendon. Then when we get into the, when we take deep to the plantar aponeurosis, there are structures which are like muscles, nerves, and vessels. It is very difficult to identify or differentiate between these vessels and the tourniquet when we have examined the limb. So as we and our first test took almost 4 hours for us to elevate and complete the flap. And now as we progressed, as we did more and more cases, we adopted a few tricks and a few modifications based on which, you know, we are not only more comfortable in elevating a flap, but also we are able to give some sustained durable results. So in this presentation, I'll elaborate on those 10 tricks that we learned with our experience. First one is understanding the anatomy. There is no substitute to this first and most important trick. Understanding the anatomy is of supreme importance because, as I said, once we get into the plantar tissue, it can be really confusing. So the flap is based on a medial plantar artery, which is a terminal branch of posterior tibial artery, and it is a non-dominant branch. This allows us to elevate a flap in the instep area based on this non-dominant branch so that the vascularity of the foot is not compromised much. After its origin at about 1 centimeter from substantaculum tali, the medial plantar artery goes deep to the abductor hallucis muscle. When it is deep to the abductor hallucis muscle, it gives two branches. One is the superficial branch, another one is the deep branch. The superficial branch lies in the septum between the abductor hallucis muscle and the flexor digitorum brevis muscle. So this branch continues in the septum and gives multiple perforators towards the plantar skin. At the level of at the distal end of the instep area, this vascular pedicle lies in between the tendons of abductor hallucis and the tendon of flexor hallucis longus. At this level, the artery usually lies lateral to the nerve in about 70% of the cases. So this anatomy is important for us to know and plan our flaps based on this vascular pedicle in this axis. Now coming to the deep branch. The deep branch is called the deep branch because when we see from the plantar aspect of the foot, this goes deeper underneath the abductor hallucis muscle, whereas the superficial branch comes superficial to the superficial towards the skin. So this deep branch, after giving its supply to the abductor hallucis muscle, it also gives another cutaneous branch which arches dorsally and reaches towards the navicular bone, tuberosity of the navicular bone. So this skin over the tuberosity of navicular bone can also be supplied by a cutaneous branch, which can take its origin from the medial from the deep branch or from the medial plantar artery main trunk itself. So this particular cutaneous branch of the deep branch will form the basis of the medialis pedis artery flap. And this superficial branch will form the basis of the conventional medial plantar artery flap and the perforator flap based on it. So various flap patterns that we can elevate based on this axis will include the conventional medial plantar artery flap, which is an axial pattern flap, which can be either a proximally based flap or a distally based flap. When it is proximally based, it is used to cover the heel predominantly, most commonly. It can also reach the posterior aspect of the heel and the tender Achilles area. Sometimes it is also used to cover the medial malleolus region. The medial plantar artery perforator flap. This flap is based purely on the perforator from the superficial branch of the medial plantar artery. Here, this particular skin territory from the superficial branch, based on this particular flap, based on this perforator, can be elevated either as a perforator flap or as a free flap. This flap was perforator, medial plantar artery perforator flaps was described by Professor Rishao Koshima in 2001 and in two articles in 2001 and 2007. As a free flap, this flap is used to reconstruct the defects in the fingers and the palm. And this flap can also be elevated as including a portion of the superficial artery, a superficial branch of the medial plantar artery, to bridge vessel defects in the fingers. From the deep branch, we have the abductor hallucis muscle, which can be used as a flap also, or which can be used in combination with a medial plantar artery flap, which I'll be showing with examples later. The cutaneous branch, again, as I said, supplies the medialis pedis branch, which can be elevated from this area. This flap can be useful in resurfacing the exposed tendo Achilles region in the posterior aspect of the ankle and heel. As a free flap, medial plantar artery flap can be used to resurface fingers and molar aspect of hand. And distally based flaps can be used to reconstruct the mid third and the distal third of foot. the vascular basis of the distally based flaps will be based on the communications between the superficial branch of the medial plantar artery and the dorsalis pedis system across the between the perforators at the level of the neck of metatarsals. Also, the lateral plantar artery, which forms the deep arch of the plant foot, gives a few branches which can supplement the blood flow through the distal as a retrograde flow through the distal part of the superficial branch of medial plantar artery. And the medialis pedis flap, since it contains the skin which is of a mixture of both glabrous and thin skin, it can also be used to reconstruct the dorsum of finger defects as a free flap. Flexibility of the medial plantar axis is also very evident based on these articles that are found in the literature. This particular version of the flap is called as Y2V advancement flap. Here, the bipedicle nature of the flap, the one pedicle of the flap is the distal flow from the superficial distal edge of the superficial branch of the medial plantar artery, and the other pedicle is through the lateral plantar artery and its arch. Here, the medial plantar artery is ligated. The posterior tibial artery is in continuity with the lateral plantar artery, which continues at the plantar arch, and perforators from this particular axis supply the flap. Without cutting this medial plantar artery origin at this level, it will not be possible for us to advance the flap distally. That is probably the reason why medial plantar artery is ligated at this point, and based on the other pedicle, it is advanced to cover the distal aspect of the foot. This modification is another interesting modification where it can be used as a chimeric flap all three components, the medialis pedis component, the conventional medial plantar artery flap component, and the abductor hallucis component, all three can be based on a common posterior tibial artery and done as a free flap to cover a defect which might be this kind of a flap. Another modification that is reported in the literature is used in the form of a free flap to cover the opposite foot with based on the posterior tibial artery. Here, two skin paddles are elevated. The one in the lower third of the leg is elevated based on a posterior tibial artery perforator. The one in the distal, one in the instep area elevated based on medial plantar artery. This medial plantar artery territory is used to cover the plantar region and the lower third of the leg, based on the posterior tibial artery perforator, is used to reconstruct the dorsum. Of course, we have not had experiences. We just wanted to elaborate the versatility of the medial plantar axis. So the next trick is to prepare the patients properly. We need to prepare the patients both as a whole and also the defect. There is a saying that we normally say that our reconstruction is only going to be as good as the debridement that we do. Hence, the debridement has to be very meticulous. We need to, if needed, we might also take the help of negative pressure wound therapy to optimize the wound. X-ray of the foot is also important to rule out osteomyelitis, to assess the bone, and more importantly, used to assess the ankle joint and the arch of the foot, so that we make sure that the instep area is still the non-weight-bearing area of the foot. If the instep area is not going to be the non-weight-bearing area of the foot, then we will not be able to harvest this flap because then this portion of the skin is not going to be expendable. Vascular assessment is another is of equal importance, where preoperatively we palpate for dorsalis pedis artery and posterior tibial artery, and we routinely take an arterial Doppler to make sure that we have triphasic flow in both anterior tibial and posterior tibial arteries. We have not done a CT angiogram for a pedicled medial plantar artery till now. So then we need to optimize the patient, both considering the general conditions and comorbidities and the investigations pertaining to anesthesia. Using a handheld Doppler on the preoperative day, we try to mark the perforators along the axis of the superficial branch of the medial plantar artery. And we can also use the handheld Doppler as a rough guide to assess flow from either antegrade and retrograde flow. The test, which is very similar to the Allen's test that we do to assess the flow between the radial and ulnar artery. Then we need to plan the flap. So the planning of the flap and marking of the flap is again a very important step, where we can choose the pattern and the axis of rotation based on the requirement of the defect. So we draw a line from the posterior most point of the calcaneum to the head of the metatarsal, which can be continued further towards the great toe. And this line is where the axis of the artery lies. So the flap is centered on this particular line. Then the entire instep area can be used and extending a little medially over the abductor hallucis, over the skin, over the abductor hallucis territory also. The largest flap that we have elevated in our experience, in our study, is around 9 into 7 centimeters. And the distally based flap again can be planned where we can ligate at the medial plantar artery origin level and flip the flap to cover the defects in the distal third of foot. Again, in the midfoot region, the same flap can be same axis can be used for either as a distally based or as a proximally based flap to cover the midfoot defects. Next, coming to this is the second most important point that we modified and which helped us to improve on our comfort zone with respect to this flap. One is the tourniquet control. We generally don't exsanguinate the limb, as I said earlier. The presence of blood in the veins are very important to elevate the flap because, especially in case of diabetic patients, where the vascularity, where the muscles are generally more fatty in nature, the entire tissue plane looks yellow, and it is very difficult to identify the vascular pedicle or the nerve, or sometimes the facial strands, or even the muscle also. Hence, we just elevate the foot for a minute. We elevate the tourniquet and then we carry on with the operation. Other important trick is to bring the foot to the edge of the table. Something like what we do while we do a cleft palate surgery. We bring the foot as distal to the table as possible and we sit at the leg end of the table facing the plantar surface of the foot. This way our dissection becomes a lot easier. I mean, we find it very easy to dissect when we find ourselves in this position. Then it's usually good to have a sandbag underneath the foot so that the ergonomics are right. Once we start the flap harvest, the distal incision is made first. As soon as we make the incision, we go deep into the superficial tissue. The first layer where we get confused is the plantar aponeurosis. Everything will look like a tendon here, so we'll be scared to incise. But generally, the most superficial dense tissue that we find is the plantar aponeurosis. As we incise the plantar aponeurosis by stretching the great toe, by stretching the great toe dorsally, when we just incise the plantar aponeurosis, we feel a grating feel and a give way. Then we will find a very nice plane underneath the plantar aponeurosis where we will find the artery, vascular pedicle and the nerves and also a few tendons. So this is how we identify the plantar aponeurosis. Once we identify the plantar aponeurosis and cells, our dissection is carried on in the medial aspect where the abductor hallucis, just over the abductor hallucis muscle. Here the plane of the dissection will be just superficial to the epimysium of the abductor hallucis muscle, and we will stop our dissection when we reach the septum. Then we will do the lateral dissection over the flexor digitorum brevis muscle. Again, we will reach the septum from the lateral aspect. So once we have reached the septum from both sides, we start elevating the flap from the distal to the proximal, distal to the proximal. And we identify the nerve and preserve it. We'll just ligate the artery and then lift it up along with the septum underneath the vascular pedicle. So once we have harvested the vascular pedicle, we found the vascular pedicle in the plane, it is important that we preserve the nerves which are going to the great toe and the lesser toes, and most of the plantar aponeurosis will be harvested along with the flap. And this is the most interesting part of the dissection, where we'll find the twig which is supplying the medial plantar, the instep flap territory. So once we, halfway through the dissection, once we find this particular branch entering the flap, it is important that we preserve the structure and do an intraneural dissection as proximal as possible, so that this will allow us to increase the arc of rotation for to enable us to reach the defect as a sensate flap. The most important trick in the intraoperative phase during the flap harvest is how we handle the abductor hallucis muscle. Initially, and even in some books say this, initially when we started doing a flap, there is a description where they'll ask us to incise proximally and to identify the posterior tibial artery first, and then continue the dissection from proximal to distal aspect.
Narayana Murthy.
Sir.
Sorry to interrupt, but you have just 5 minutes more. We need to finish before the program, APSA program.
Okay, sir, I'll do. So, distal, the abductor hallucis flap vascularity can be affected. Hence, we can either do it as a, hence, we can, we used to remove this abductor hallucis because we had a doubtful, we were doubtful about the vascularity, but when we do that, we expose the tendons and nerves. So, we try to preserve the abductor hallucis and pivot the flap at this point where it, where the superficial branch of the medial plantar artery comes out, enters the septum. So then we pivot and do propel the flap and to cover the heel defect. Abductor hallucis can also be used as a used to fill the defect in the cavity in the heel region as a chimeric pattern. I mean, harvested as a chimeric pattern. So the muscle is rotated and filled, and the defect is filled with the muscle. Then the flap based on the superficial branch is again rotated to cover the defect. Post-op protocol is very similar to other flaps that we do in the lower limb. Only thing is we remove the sutures about 2 to 3 weeks time. We start partial weight bearing and compression therapy from about 4 to 5 weeks. And total weight bearing we allow the patient once the wound is healed after 8 weeks. Then we'll have to watch out for congestion, like how we monitor the free flaps. So when there is venous congestion, early stages, the removal of few stitches and letting out of hematoma probably helped us to salvage this flap. We may not do anything. And if it is little more severe, then we remove the entire impress inset and we applied a VAC therapy, and again we were able to get away with it. This flap, again, we had a partial necrosis of about 3 centimeters due to congestion in spite of VAC therapy. But again, we could manage it conservatively. The donor site can be a nagging problem. Usually there is an epidermal necrosis, which usually settles by itself, so you won't have to do much. Only in 2 cases, we had to do a skin graft secondarily. Coming to the compression garment, which helps, though the flap settles quite well, but the graft area can be a problem. So application of compression garment with silicone sheet in the postoperative period and following it religiously helps us to give a good stable scar even in the grafted region of the instep. These are some of our long-term results. And this is one for the unstable scar, another one here for the melanoma defect. During the follow-up, offloading is still important because one of these patients, after 1.5 years probably, we had come back with callosity here. Then we did a tangential excision, re-customized the footwear, and it's almost healed conservatively. Some patients come with non-related ulcers or ulcer of recurrence. So that would, we have not had any recurrence of ulcers till now in the 20 patients that we have done. For the, this was a thermal bunch due to the neuropathic nature of the foot. Luckily, again, with conservative treatment for about 2 weeks, we could achieve almost near perfect healing. This patient, the flap healed quite well, but later he developed cellulitis for which amputation of the toe was done elsewhere. Probably the metatarsal ligaments, transverse metatarsal ligaments were not addressed. So he developed flaying of the foot. So when we came back after 18 months, then we saw, we called him for this presentation to get a picture. So we are planning to again do a formal reamputation of the metatarsal, re-achieve the arch, and then we'll take it forward about how to heal the ulcer. So to summarize, understanding anatomy, ergonomics while operating, abductor hallucis handling, compression garment and offloading footwear, we are able to achieve consistent results. So to conclude, the medial plantar artery flap is not only a reliable flap, but also has a versatile axis, which allows us to customize our flap based on our requirement. It can also be taken as a free flap or a primary flap. Of course, donor site issues are there, but again, most of them can be come over by reassurance of the patient. We should watch out for Charcot's deformity, both preoperatively and postoperatively. If it is present preoperatively, we should avoid harvesting a medial plantar artery flap. Thank you again, and wishing all a happy plastic surgery day from Team Savitam Medical Devices.
Thank you, Dr. Narayana Murthy, for the excellent presentation of a very important flap. My question is it a sensate flap?
Yes, sir.
You're not mentioned anything about the nerve.
Sir, I had mentioned about the nerve also, sir. I had showed a picture of the nerve dissection and intraneural dissection.
Okay, you take a superficial branch which goes to that skin parallel.
Yes, sir.
The main distal nerve is not disturbed.
No, sir. We do intraneural dissection to continue the dissection proximally, and we flip it over along with the vascular.
Any questions from the participants? That's only a comment. Why are the steps of the procedures termed as tricks? Good illustration of steps, right, Dr. Ram?
No, sir. Thank you, sir. No, actually, the reason I called it as a trick is, as I said, initially, all the steps we are finding difficulty. So okay. I thought, and we learned it over the experience that we had. So if the steps where we need to concentrate more and we have an easy way out, I have mentioned it as tricks.
Good, good. Any other questions?
There is
in today's world, Gopi has asked one, today's world of microsurgery, what is the indication of this flap?
We can do this flap even then for a healed effect. This flap again gives like for like tissue replacement. It is going to be sensate. The interface between the flap and the native skin is going to be glabrous. So the healing in this process is also going to be good. So that is this flap can still be used for ipsilateral as a pedicle flap for ipsilateral defect. For as a microvascular flap, also this flap can be used for contralateral healed defects. Or defects in the hand, palmar region of the hand, or fingers. Again, medial plantar artery, if we have to go a little further, this medial plantar artery perforator flap can be done we can have a very small flap based on the perforator, and we can do by super micro technique, we can do reconstruct defects in there.
One more question.
Awesome. Yes, sir.
By Rakesh Kumar, please explain on the extent of the flap, I mean how far it can go.
Yes. How extent of the flap for dissection, it is restricted to non-weight bearing region of the foot, which is the medial, mid-third.
I think he means the reach of the flap.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So with respect to reach of the flap, it depends on till where we dissect. So we dissect the pedicle of the medial plantar artery. Like when we stop at the point where it is entering the septum, we can only propel the flap and cover to the heel. If we need to take it further posteriorly, we can dissect, we can ligate the medial plant, we can ligate the lateral plantar artery branch and take it along with the posterior tibial artery and take it up to the posterior heel and posterior ankle. We can also cover medial malleolus, tendo-Achilles defects over tendo-Achilles and posterior heel with the flap.